Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'd like to ask Tom Manning if he'll have the invocation.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we again are grateful for the opportunity to meet, do the work of this county, do the work for the citizens. We pray for your guidance during these times of turbulence. Help calm our fears as it relates to war, as it relates to sickness, as it relates to our economy here at home. We ask that you bless the folks that are in this room tonight. Watch over us as we make decisions for the betterment of all citizens of the county. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to call on Ryan Haygood for the Special Olympics.
Well, good evening, Commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to address you tonight, and I'd like for you to join me in welcoming some folks here to the meeting. I'm here tonight to recognize two of our Special Olympic Alamance County athletes, Mr. Alan Harrelson. Alan is here tonight. And Mr. Philip Buzzle. Philip was not unable to attend. These two individuals take part in our Special Olympics golf program and have been selected to participate in the Special Olympics U.S. National Golf Tournament in Port Lucie, Florida, which this is just a tremendous honor that's been afforded to them. And it's akin to, I would say, to being able to play in the U.S. Open. It's a wonderful invitation to play. It's a reflection of their skill and their performance at the state level. So I'd like to ask Alan if you would please stand, if you don't mind standing up. And also in attendance, also in attendance with us tonight is Alan's coach, Mr. Mike Buzzle. Mike? And Philip wasn't, yes. Philip wasn't able to attend, but his coach is here this evening, Mr. Richard Neal. Richard's here. And our team coach over the entire Special Olympics Alamance County golf team is here tonight, too, Mr. Doug Bailey. And I would not miss an opportunity to recognize Alan's mother, who is also here, Charlene Harrelson. There's a lot of time and effort put in to achieving something like this, both by the athletes and the volunteers. And we felt like it was appropriate to come here tonight, give them an opportunity to be recognized. And we appreciate your indulgence. Thank you. And if I would ask one, if you could indulge me in one more thing, as they're getting ready to leave, they're going to Florida to compete. I thought it might be nice if we did the Special Olympics oath together, kind of as a way to send them off. I'll be happy to lead it. It's very short. If you'll repeat after me, anyone who wants to participate, let me win.
Let me win.
But if I cannot win,
let me be brave in the attempt. Let me be brave in the attempt.
Good luck.
The next thing on the agenda is public comments, and we have Mike Kelly.
Good evening, gentlemen. Good evening. And congratulations, Bill, on your temporary promotion. I just wanted to come before you guys tonight and make one final attempt to urge you to reconsider this proposed sale of the property on Park Avenue. I understand that you have convictions, deep-held convictions, most of you that I know personally, that you want to be helpful to the handicapped, and obviously I share that. But I'm concerned that this property and the liquidation of it is premature. There's not been a real opportunity for public input, and that's why I came before you 2 weeks ago. So I'm asking you again tonight to please reconsider. Shut down that bidding process. If you want to go ahead with the sale of the property, do it at public auction. There's another opportunity to sell according to general statutes, which I have researched. And if you do that, everything is out in the open and nobody's going to question it. There's no issues for the board or for the citizens. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is information on state ISO inspections. Tim Bradley, Assistant State Fire Marshal.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Pleasure to be here. I rarely get the opportunity to speak in my home county. I've been a native of Alamance County all my life. And
you're also a member of the Mebane
City Council. So I'll more often sit on that side of the table. So it's probably a little easier in situations such as this, but more difficult when you have to come to a conclusion or decision on something. I've been in the fire service 37 years. I served all 37 on the Mebane Fire Department and have been with the State Fire Marshal's Office 26 years. By statute, the North Carolina Commissioner of Insurance is State Fire Marshal, and that's why the State Fire Marshal's Office is in the Department of Insurance, and I manage it for them. What I understand I'm here for is to give you a little background on what's commonly referred to as ISO. It's a little more complex than that. ISO is actually a company that does commercial risks. It's Insurance Services Office. Insurance and the fire service has been tied very closely since the early 1900s. In fact, in 1907, North Carolina established Fireman's Relief Fund, which was funded from insurance receipts to protect firefighters and to provide benefits for them, and that fund still exists today. But in the early 60s, they began to recognize that if they measured the fire department's capabilities to suppress fires and averaged that out over a period of time, they could come to a little bit better capability of providing risk analysis on what property owners, commercial locations, and businesses should pay on fire insurance. So they established what's known as the ISO standard, and it's an engineering standard. Today it's about 512 pages. And what it does is establishes a grading scale from 10, which is an unprotected area, no fire department, or a fire department that's not rated, all the way down to 1, which is the best. There's only 14 departments in the United States that are 1. The city of Greensboro is 1, and that's the only one in North Carolina. Most departments fall somewhere between 9 and 5 if they're volunteer, and somewhere between 6 and 2 if they're career or combination. In Alamance County, I would say to you that you have a very well-rated series of departments in the county. I think you should be proud of the fact that many of the rural departments have received what we know as commercial or municipal ratings, below an 8. But anyway, in 1963, they began to develop a standard, and this evolved over a period of time. For example, in the 1960s and into the 70s, 4 miles was the maximum road mile distance on a volunteer fire department. That went to 5 in the 1980s, and when we started doing inspections in 2001, we took it to 6 miles. And that's because of increased road conditions, better notification, and quicker response times for fire departments, better water capabilities and such. But the Insurance Services Office rated fire departments in North Carolina as they did across the country until 2001. The General Assembly recognizing that the Insurance Services Office was taking somewhere between 15 to 20 years to come back around to a department, and that the way fire departments in North Carolina were progressing, they didn't feel like we were taking advantage of improvements for homeowner insurance rates. They actually gave that responsibility for municipalities under 100,000 to the North Carolina Office of State Fire Marshal. So we began rating, and we do a number of things. We come in and we will do a class for the county or an area. We'll do come in and do a preview for the fire department so that they get the maximum. What our intent is to ensure that the maximum benefit or number of points they can get out of what they provide, they get. And in Alamance County, you have an excellent fire marshal, and Alamance County is taking advantage of that. And I'm sure you've heard the term, we need this for ISO rating. If we don't keep this, we can't get our ISO rating. And I won't say that that's a too commonly used term. Sometimes it's absolutely true. Sometimes it's just a statement that if we don't continue to do what we've been doing, we're not going to be able to maintain a rating. We get around the department somewhere between 5 and 7 years. We will come in earlier if the fire department believes it has improved to the extent that they can improve their rating. When we come in, we evaluate the department on 3 levels: communications, the fire department itself, and water supply. So as you can see, 2 of the areas the fire department has very little control over. In Alamance County, for example, you control the communications, so the fire department doesn't have a lot of say in how many operators they have, how many phone lines, how many dispatch circuits. The same pretty much in water supply. although departments can put in dry hydrants on ponds, municipal water systems are where you gain the most points, where you put water systems in the county, and some counties have elected to do that simply for fire protection, but most of the time it's for commercial growth. And of course, fire departments get the advantage of, once those hydrants are put in, that gives them additional points on their water supply. But when we come in and evaluate them in these three areas, we look at such things as manpower, the training the individuals have had, the number of trucks they have that have passed service tests. Years ago, when I first became a fire chief in 1982, it was a common knowledge that at 20 years, the fire truck would not pass ISO anymore. That's no longer true. All the truck has to do is pass service test. So you may get 35 years out of a truck. You might not get but 15. It has to pass the pump test for UL. We come in and evaluate that, and if a fire chief says, well, we've got to replace this truck to meet our ISO rating, that what they're essentially saying is it does no longer pass the service test, and we're not going to be able to count this truck as a rating. And even though they've got the truck, looks fine, runs fine, but it doesn't pump the flow necessary, it will be just as if they didn't have it when the inspectors come in. I want to make this point fairly clear. There are a lot of things that seem, why? If a truck's rated 1,000 gallons a minute and it'll pump 920, why won't that count? It's just like any other standard. 70's passing, 69's failing. The student with a 69 may be just as smart, but they didn't make a 70. And so you have to draw a line somewhere. So we require, as does ISO, that trucks pass service tests. The reason we use the ISO standard in developing our own was, one, the complexity of developing it, but mainly because the insurance industry bases their risk analysis for setting rates on ISO standards, or the ISO rating, or fire suppression grade is the proper term. So if we came up with this entire new standard that we felt fit North Carolina better, there would be a huge lack of trust with the insurance industry to place their risk on that standard, because there's no history behind it. And as I said, since 1963, they've continually evaluated losses as compared to ratings of departments, so their risk analysis underwriters can accurately predict where these ratings are going. There's a couple of things that ISO impacts the budget severely, particularly with volunteer fire departments this day and time. When I was fire chief in the mid-80s, volunteers weren't really that hard to come by. But now most young people work two jobs, so it's getting harder and harder to find people, particularly during the day, to fill the necessary response requirements for fire response. A lot of departments have had to hire people to do that, which, as you know, personnel cost in any organization becomes the real budget issue. Replacing trucks, sending people to training, paying for training, repairs and equipment, and there's not a lot of equipment, but there's not that's specifically required by the standard, other than the standard stuff like axes and things of that nature. One thing you have to recognize too today, though, that in the mid-1980s, it cost $800 to buy a set of turnout gear for a firefighter. Today it costs close to $5,000. So an air pack, the last one I remember our department getting when I was chief, was $950. Now those air packs go anywhere between $4,000 and $5,000. So ISO has an impact on budget, and it's not so much that that it's being required, that if we don't do this, the state's going to fine us. There are actually no standards from the state. There's no requirement that Alamance County have rated fire departments. There's no requirement that Alamance County have fire departments that are 5, 6, 7, or 8. That's Alamance County's decision and the local community that the fire department supports. But if they're going to maintain that rate, once they achieve it, and the insurance adjusters are going to adjust and set risk analysis on that, then they have to maintain that certain number of points they require for that level. So it does have an impact on fire department budgets. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have. That's a real generic overview. I didn't want to get specific. Fire engines, for example, are based on 1.5 miles. So if you got a 10-mile square district, then you just divide that by 1.5 to tell you how many equipped and manned engines you have. It's a pretty broad standard, but the actual rating comes out to a point system somewhere between 1 and 10. 10 meaning you don't get any credit for a fire department, 9 meaning you're rating, but you're just into the rating. From an insurance perspective, though, homeowner cost dropping from a 10 to a 9, in other words, providing a rating department may mean anywhere between a 50 and 60% drop in home insurance rates, home fire insurance rates. Dropping from a 9, which is a rural rating, to a municipal rating, 8.76, could mean another 12 to 30%, depending on the company, the agency, and how the company's discounting, the whole thing in terms. So there is an advantage to maintaining or improving that rate. Now, you reach a certain point where on homeowners, it doesn't have any effect. Right now, that's somewhere between a 5 and a 6. If a fire department gets to a 5, then going to a 4 is not really going to help homeowners. It will help businesses. It will help on commercial risk analysis for industry, but it really won't help the average homeowner. Let's have a really huge home. So when someone says, well, how good is good enough, it's really a local decision. That's why the state says you determine the quality you want. That's what you need to fund. That's what the fire department needs to strive to achieve, and we'll come in and make sure that you that they're achieving that, and insurance companies can trust that if they write this department's capabilities to this, that's the department's capabilities. I'll be happy to answer any questions. I'm not sure.
If a fire department desires to increase their rating, do they just call y'all and you go out and give them a special test?
Mm-hmm.
At that particular time?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. We'll come back every 5 to 7 years just to maintain.
Uh-huh.
But if 3 years after the inspection, the city or the county or the local fire district, tax district has said we're going to allow you to hire 3 people and they're thinking, well, maybe this is going to help our rating, then we'll come back in and do a reevaluation. And sometimes the point spread is it's like making 100 on the test. If you get an 82, you're an 8. If you get a 44, you're a 4. So if you can drop that 44 to a 38, you're a 3. And so that little swing between a 6 and a 5 or a 7 and a 6 may be 1 or 2 points. So if they were close, and we'll tell them, we're very upfront. If we see a fire, if we come to a fire department and we say, you know, if you would use your mutual aid engines to set up the water point and use your engine, your tankers for response to the fire and for moving water, it would pick you up 2 points. We'll tell them. There's no secrets. It's a very complex standard. We'll come in and do a class. We'll come in and meet with the chief before. We'll if a fire department calls and says we're wanting to build a second station to pick up an area and rate it, where is the best place? We'll do a water distribution analysis and say your best point pickup for your insurance grade or your fire suppression grade would be to put this in this little half mile area right here. We'll do that. We look at ourselves as not only a resource to the fire service, but to make sure that we maintain that trust with the insurance industry, that they just don't shoot rates up because they no longer trust that if the fire department says it's got this capabilities, it actually does. But yes, sir, we'll come back in at any time and do that rating.
So the number of personnel, permanent full-time personnel, does make a difference in fire departments.
Absolutely. On the point system, and as I said, this is an engineering standard. It's hard to explain this to a volunteer, but I've been a volunteer for 37 years, so I can say it. It takes 4 volunteers to meet to equal 1 paid person. And that's the number of reasons a paid person is there all the time. Volunteer may or may not be. A paid person gets there quicker. Volunteer has to come with a car or ride to the scene. So if you have a department and they're really struggling with making the points on their manpower, adding 1 paid person would be the same thing as adding 4 active volunteers. You also recognize that training for a career person, when that person's career, becomes much easier, so they actually pick up points on training, which you get points for. In the grading standard, you get points for how many books you have in your library, how many training hours you have, whether you've done pre-plans on buildings as far as knowing what they are before you get there. You get credit for all those things. So it's pretty complex, but personnel is a big issue, and we are constantly having departments sitting on the border of being unrated because they can't get volunteers. The recruitment and retention in any organization that they're looking for volunteers today is getting tough, and it's not because people are less less American or less have less volunteer spirit. Some of them are working two jobs to make ends meet, and it's getting tougher to get them. But personnel is a big issue right now, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah. Do you do fire departments all across the state?
Anything under 100,000. So we do all but 17 municipalities. Burlington, 100,000. Burlington, all the departments in Alamance County fall under our jurisdiction. Greensboro, obviously, is still graded by ISO. And Greensboro, for example, is one. With all recent annexations, I suspect the next time ISO visits them, they're going to have a tough time because, you know, you've got to have so many departments per square mile, and if you're annexing territory and not putting fire stations in it, you get behind pretty quick. So it's very difficult to maintain it. The question is, the city of Greensboro, city of Burlington, city of Mebane, you have to make a decision. Where do we want to be? Is it worth the cost to maintain, or do we want to back up a little bit? Mebane, for example, has a particular ISO rating, and we're comfortable with that. If it costs a substantial amount of money to improve it, then we'd rather maintain. But if it looked like we were going to back up, we'd want to make corrections to stay where we're at. So Fire Protection North Carolina is a local decision, and that's the way it should be. Tax districts are established, and those tax districts often have commissions that recommend budgets to you folks, and they have public hearings, and the local community decides what the tax rate should be and what level of fire protection they want. If they're told by the fire department, you know, if we could drop from an 8 to a 6, you'd improve your homeowner's insurance 8% to 20%. The citizens may say, well, let's increase the tax. Or if they say, if we don't hire some people, we're going to move back to a rural grade instead of municipal grade, then the citizens may say it's worth it to us for you to increase our fire tax. And, of course, you have the final decision on those, whether it's a service district that was established by the county or a tax district established by a vote of the people, you still have the final say on that final vote. But it's the local folks that have the input on what quality fire protection they want.
How do the departments communicate that to the taxpayer to let them know? I mean, because you're talking about something that's not set over here because they don't know where the rating may end up, but if they needed $50,000 to improve the rating, and, you know, to how do you communicate that to a citizen to say, well, you know, your tax rate on your fire tax is going to go up, but here's what you would save as a homeowner?
It really boils down to public hearings and public notification. We encourage departments that we rate to try to get the press involved. Most people don't know the complexity. Most people think the fire whistle goes off, a bunch of people jump on the fire truck and ride to the fire. It's a whole lot more complex than that. And when you talk about, well, my fire tax is going to go up a penny, that's going to be $12 more. Okay. But your insurance is going to go up 9%. If you don't, that's going to be $62 on a $300,000
out.
So it is a communication issue. And we encourage, of course, they're supposed to have public hearings if they're a tax district that they voted in by the people. They're supposed to have public hearings. If there's a service district, then you can either require them to have a public hearing or you can have it yourself. The public's supposed to know about the budget increase. And at that time, they need to be told, here's the ramifications if we don't increase. Here's the ramifications if we cut the budget, and keep them informed. And sometimes it's very – one of the problems, though, is very hard to quantify. Insurance in North Carolina, like any state, companies discount. So the established rate set by the insurance commissioner, a company may discount. And if you say, well, you'd save 30% on the rate established by the insurance commissioner, but in fact, once the company has been discounting for smoke detectors and double deadbolt locks and things of that nature, it actually may be 8%. So it really, agents have to look at it, and we also encourage the fire departments to talk to the local agents and talk to them and say, for example, if I was fire chief of a community and didn't know, then I would want to know what that margin of error was for residential, because that's your biggest number of people, particularly in rural districts. If I go to a 6 from a 6 to a 5, is it going to make a difference? That's easy to do. You just get a local agent to run the numbers, or better yet, two or three of them, so you get a good average of the companies, and just let them run the numbers and see. And if it doesn't do you any good to go to a 6, then you have to ask yourself, well, how much commercial property do I have? Because it does have going from 6 to a 5 or a 4 or 3 does have a different effect on commercial property and businesses. But for residential, normally right now, 10 years ago it was 3 to 4. Now it's 5 to 6. And that's a moving target, but that's, you just have to keep up with that. They use the term ISO very loosely, but it's actually a fire suppression grade. Mm-hmm. And we report that information to ISO, so they still have a nucleus of information from around the country. And then ISO publishes it for the North Carolina Rate Bureau, and all agents get a quarterly publication from the Rate Bureau put out by ISO that says this fire department is rated this. And it's getting really, to tell you how tight it's getting, agents now are using GPS at the residence. And when I say we went to 6 miles, one of the reasons we went to 6 miles is if you drove 5 road miles to the entrance to a new subdivision on at the edge of your fire district and you had homes a half a mile down in the subdivision, they're now in an unrated district. Even though they were in that circle that looked like it was the fire district, they're not actually rated because it's road miles. So we went to a 6 because we thought since the 1970s that the road conditions, the dispatching pagers, electronics, and the newer apparatus gave better response time. And then the insurance industry agreed and allowed us to do that. So
our interest in having you come here was the result of our budget process where, you know, we hear about these ratings just as soon as we start talking to the fire chiefs or when we go out and visit. Number one, you do take into consideration everything in the territory, whether their territory, residential, occupied dwellings, commercial, and so forth. And my only question is, how do you think Alamance County stacks up with other counties overall, average, above average, below, as far as these ratings go as a whole?
As a whole, I would say overall in the state, better. In the Piedmont, average or just a little bit above average. If you go further east or further west, you have more rural counties, less density. A 10 cent on the tax rate here may generate a $200,000, 10 cent on the tax rate in Currituck County may generate $3,500. So but the density in comparison to those counties, Alamance County is much better. I say in the Piedmont, above average.
With our ratings?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good.
Mm-hmm. Good quality fire protection, and I would say that in addition to the homeowner savings, it also makes it attractive for industry. And industry typically develops on the realm of municipalities, and then the municipalities will jump out and get them. But when a lot of times when they're first looking, there's a piece of properties in a rural area, and the difference between an 8 and a 5 in that rural area is going to make a difference in their commercial risk.
Just curious, did the fire at Eastern Guilford High School have any bearing at all on what their fire departments were, how they were reviewed and so forth?
No, ISO actually experimented in the late 70s and early 80s with rating based on loss records. The problem with that is you can really have some bad losses to skew the outcome, or you can have a period of time when they don't really have any fires to skew the outcome too. So it really wasn't a measurement. What they came back to was, if you evaluate a department's suppression capability, then and given the same notification time, development of the fire, type of the building, they're going to be this much better, this much worse. The Eastern Guilford fire, for example, you couldn't have put that out with airplanes dropping water because it got into a roof pocket system, a rubber roof pocket system, and what it looked like a massive fire was just a roof burning off. There actually wasn't. If you had courage, you could just walk under it. You had a rubber constructed bar joist roof assembly about this thick burning solid rubber, and it just burnt right across. And of course, in it, once it lost that structural support, it began to fall in. There's no evaluation of an after the fire as far as the rating goes, Commissioner. Good question. We get that question a lot. And you know, you say, well, if they lose a fire like that, how could they possibly be a 5, or how could they possibly be a 6? I've seen some fires you just can't put out, and I've seen some really nasty ones that just went out just like that. I think everyone determined it was better to stick with the capability, and that gives everybody the same fair starting point.
Well, I'll stop by there, and I don't mean to belabor it, but
Northern Guilford. You know, they've got Northern Guilford High School, well, here, and they've got Northern Guilford Middle School here, and they've got this real small little volunteer fire department right in the middle. I guess it's volunteer. And I went up there one Saturday, knocked on the door, and went in. One guy there. And I said, what's, you know, his girlfriend had left, and I think he thought I was her coming back in. And I'm not telling on him, I hope. But I never watched the TV. Anyway, and I said, well, now, what are you going to do? You know, is your department enough to take care of Northern Guilford and the middle school that wasn't here 2 years ago? You know, and he said, well, if something happened, they'd have to bring in a lot of other people. And I was wondering then, you know, how would that have, you know, were their ratings altered at that point due to having all that extra stuff to cover? So.
No, most departments, for example, in Alamance County, Fawcett's rating is also determined by mutual aid dispatch. So they get credit for AO's water. They get credit for Station 13's water, Northeastern, and they get credit for Hall River's water. If three departments are dispatched, you get credit. That's what I was saying earlier. If we see that they would benefit by using Hall River's engine to set up a water point, we'll tell them because they may pick up some points. That department in Eastern Guilford, they probably had nine departments there before it was over, in addition to Greensboro's ladder. And here's another issue. Remember that in an area like a rural area, you can't tax nuclear facilities, power plants, public schools, government buildings. So, you know, it's like the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. Chapel Hill gets $1,000 a year from the state to cover the University of North Carolina, which is a huge fire load. Boone Fire Department gets very little to cover Appalachian State University. That volunteer fire department probably was not getting any money from a tax district that had those schools in, unless they were given supplements by the county. But there's a lot of those. There's some huge facilities in rural areas that are covered by a fire department with no paid personnel and, you know, one bay, one station with three bays.
That's true.
Any other questions? Certainly a pleasure to be here, Mr. Chairman.
Tim, thank you for coming.
If you have any other questions, you just put them through your fire marshal. I'll be happy to respond in writing, but I appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.
The next item on the list is a presentation of Alamance County Historical Courthouse video. Scott Ward.
MIS. Good evening, Commissioners. I am here tonight to present a video to you. If you'd like to sit back, pop some popcorn.
Did you bring the popcorn?
I ate all mine on the way over. I'm going to get Kenny over here to hit the play button a couple times, and we'll get this video started and hope you enjoy it. We'll talk about it after. The Historic Courthouse, Alamance County's enduring history. It's been more than 350 years since John Lederer first set eyes on the rich soil of this land in 1670. It would be another 179 years, however, until a resolution presented by Giles Mevin to the North Carolina State Legislature would ultimately result in the creation of Alamance County on April 24, 1849. Further legislation called for the county to purchase up to 100 acres of land to establish a county seat. That land was to be sold off as lots, and the profits from that sale would be used to construct a courthouse and a jail. Prior to the formation of Alamance County, court was held at various locations for the citizens of Western Orange County, so that they wouldn't have to make the difficult journey to the courthouse at Hillsboro. One of those sites is believed to have been located off of what is today called Basin Road, northeast of the town of Hall River and east of the town of Green Level, near Graham Mevin Lake. Once Alamance County was established in 1849, the county court and commissioners met at the now-demolished Providence Meeting House near the Providence Christian Church in Graham. The first meeting of the county commissioners was held on June 4, 1849, and after setting a local property tax rate of 35¼ cents and a poll tax rate of 73¾ cents, commissioners turned to the business of the courthouse. A budget of $8,000 was set to purchase land for the county seat and to build the new courthouse. The original plan was for the courthouse and county seat to be located near the center of the new county, but the land there near exit 147 in Graham was too soggy and marshy, and so the seat was moved a short distance north. A square of 75 acres of land was purchased for $623 from three farmers, John A. Holt, Joseph M. Freeland, and William Clendenin. The purchased land was subdivided into lots, which was sold for varying prices to local groups and investors for over $5,500, save for a 297-foot square in the center, which was to be reserved for the courthouse square. The 1852 courthouse was constructed with brick for $6,400, or around $163,000 in 2009 money. The roof was supposed to have been made of either tin or zinc, but there's some indications that it may have been copper at some point during its history. It featured a cupola at the top of the building, which housed a 400-pound bell, which is believed to be the only surviving piece of this original courthouse, and which currently resides at Sesquicentennial Park in the Courthouse Square in Graham. By the 1880s, after 30 years, a civil war, and a host of other local events, the courthouse's limited space and age were beginning to be a factor, and so the county approved the addition of east and west wings. Additionally, the outside of the courthouse was stuccoed. These additions cost $7,500, or $177,000 in today's money. 3 decades later, a memorial to Confederate soldiers was added to the grounds and dedicated on May 21, 1914. The original courthouse was much smaller than our present courthouse, with only 2 floors of space, and with the width of the courthouse being not much larger than our current courtroom. That small space was shared by all branches and levels of government, federal, state, and local. While there are persistent rumors of a fire at the original courthouse, it was the lack of space that fed the decision to tear down the small, aging building, which was demolished in 1923 to make way for its replacement. The historic courthouse's cornerstone was laid on November 17, 1923. Just over 1 year later, on November 23, 1924, the courthouse was dedicated by Judge W.A. Devin. At the time, the 4-story courthouse was considered to be one of the best examples of modern architecture in the state of North Carolina, and the $253,925.82 cost, or $3.16 million in 2009 money, reflected that. From that time on, the courthouse in Graham became a major center for town functions, community gatherings, and of course, government business. It has been used for celebrations and anniversaries of important historical events, cultural and intellectual events and speeches, weddings, and even the occasional fashion show. It was also used extensively during the 1920s and 30s by the local African American community as a center for social activities after church services on Sundays. The courthouse was designed by architect and Greensboro resident Harry Barton, who also designed the Guilford, Cumberland, and Johnson County courthouses. The design comes from the neoclassical revival style, which was a popular style from the 18th century until the Great Depression. Other examples can be seen in buildings like the Lincoln Memorial and Grand Central Terminal. Some of the unique elements on the outside of the courthouse include the flat roof concealed by a parapet wall and balustrades, the raised first story, the hexa-style portico with fluted Doric columns topped with acanthus and palmette flourishes and matching pilasters found throughout the structure, decorative friezes, and subtle use of multiple colors in the terracotta building material. Looking past the granite stairs and columnar iron lamps, the entrances to the courthouse feature entablatures resting on scroll consoles and decorated with a crest of Anthemian and palmette anaffixes. And of course, there are the large words, Alamance County Courthouse, at the very top of the portico. Stepping through the doors, we enter the central hallway, an open, spacious hall trimmed with fine wood and boasting an impressive ceramic mosaic tile floor, all culminating in the central octagon, where a marble medallion radiates outward. The 4 doors that lead from the center of the first floor point to the compass points, with the door leading to the Confederate Memorial being north. The first floor of the courthouse houses the offices of the Clerk of Court. The ceiling of the first floor features a type of molding that resembles teeth and is referred to as dental tooth molding. The molding in any of the rooms where the original ceiling is visible can sometimes reveal information about the original government agency that occupied that room. Some rooms have very plain molding and were used for functions like agriculture. Others, such as our courtroom, feature very detailed molding and were used to house agencies and conduct functions that were considered to have more prestige. One office, the one in the southwest corner of the first floor, hosted the original offices of the Sheriff's Department and featured wire glass windows that would be more difficult for prisoners to break through. As a part of the recent refurbishment project, the entire first floor was extensively reworked to bring the courthouse back, as closely as possible, to its original 1924 appearance, and also to make it a more accessible workspace for those who work in the courthouse. This involved removing paneling that was not part of the original design, increasing workable space, improving temperature control, restoring old covered up doors and windows, and replacing windows to improve temperature management and reduce noise. While every effort was made to preserve the history, some improvements needed a 21st century touch, including replacing the outside window fixtures that had extensive deterioration with newer fixtures. The basement area was also extensively refurbished. Improved lighting makes the basement feel much less cramped and helps to increase usable space. Extensive waterproofing has also been done to help prevent damage from decades of leaking roofs and pipes. Also, dangerous materials such as asbestos were removed from the courthouse, and while refurbishing restrooms may not be glamorous, the extensive refurbishments done to these restrooms will be a welcome change to anyone who's ever needed to use one.
That's true.
The courthouse basement featured four bathrooms, two for men and two for women. These bathrooms were split into public and staff use. However, years of use had left its mark on all of the laboratories. These bathrooms, along with the remainder of the basement, were extensively refurbished and repaired. Moving out of the basement, we focus on the courthouse stairs. Years of use and multiple coats of paint have masked the beauty of the original iron railings, which have now been restored to their original appearance. In the corners of the courthouse are rooms that were originally used for county and state government offices, but which will now be used for court officers, clerk's offices, and other uses related to the function of the courthouse. As with many neoclassical revival buildings, more flourishes were placed into the large, impressive spaces than into the smaller functional rooms. However, each room has its own use and its own character, and each one was extensively overhauled in order to improve its usability, improve temperature control, meet accessibility guidelines, and repair damage done by decades of wear and tear. This includes internal damage done by leaking pipes and a damaged roof. While the roof itself was repaired in 1996, the water damage remained. Now that damage is repaired and the rooms are ready for their assigned uses. Finally, we move into the courtroom, the grandest space in the courthouse. The courtroom features an impressive set of architectural features, including the dental tooth moldings found on the first floor, pedimented overdoors, cornices, and raised panel doors and wainscots. The large balcony and beautiful chandelier augment this stately room, and the original judge's bench from 1924 is a capstone that enriches this impressive space. Major renovations were done to the courtroom to improve upon the years of use. For many years, the courtroom windows were walled up to prevent noise from interfering with the business of the courts. Thanks to improvements in window technology, the old windows were able to be replaced with new ones that would keep out the noise, but still allow natural light and heat to be used, and as closely as possible restoring the courtroom to its original 1924 appearance. The use of natural light and heat will also help to reduce energy costs. Other additions include the replacement of most of the chairs in the courtroom with better quality seating, refurbishing the floor, restoring the wood to its original appearance, and repairing the room's fabric ceiling and installing a drop ceiling with recessed lighting. A beautiful paint scheme of yellows and off-whites augment the intricate varnish woodwork over the judge's bench. Finally, soundproofing was done to help reduce the ambient noise of the room. The result of all of these updates and all of this work is a return to the impressive space that Harry Barton originally intended, using up-to-date building techniques to ensure that his will be a lasting vision. The Alamance County courthouses have been a center for our community and a link to our common history since 1849. Our current courthouse has served our community for over 85 years, and thanks to preservation and revitalization efforts by the citizens of Alamance County, it will continue to do so for many more. We hope that our presentation has both informed and entertained you, and that you will walk away with a greater appreciation for this fantastic and impressive historical landmark.
There we go. Credits. We've worked a while on this video. Worked with a lot of good groups, a lot of good people. We got some good information. We are currently in the process of producing some DVDs that can be used. That will be given out at the September 10th opening. Let the music continue a little bit. At the September 10th opening, when we have the opening, we're going to have a group of DVDs that I'm working with Brian Haygood right now on setting up to where Loaves and Fishes will come out, and if people bring a can of food, they get a DVD. We thought that'd be a good way to help some folks in the community and to you know, give away a keepsake. In the meantime, if you'd like to watch the video again and hear my soft, sultry voice. we will be launching tonight. We will be launching a portion of our website that includes history about the courthouse and includes this video on it. And that will be available at our website at www.alamance-nc.com.
Scott, you did a good job. Yeah, we appreciate it.
You must have went to architectural school, man. All the details you were pointing out.
I was actually a history major for 2.5
years. There you
years,
go.
So history slash pre-law. So.
That was very good.
Thank you. If there are no questions.
Great job.
Thanks for sharing.
Thank you very much.
I think that's something we can be proud of.
It really is.
Thank you, Tim, for helping that process of getting that done, too.
The next item on the agenda is budget amendment number 22, Health Department, Joseph B. Bass.
Oh, my goodness.
Ooh, got a formal
official name. How'd that
We're
work?
Getting formal tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Basically, we have received a grant from the Alamance Alliance for Children and Families in the sum of $5,878, and we will be using these funds to go towards our centering pregnancy program. And the idea is to reduce the incidence of mental health issues amongst our prenatal patients, and we'll be implementing a new didactic behavioral therapy program using experts to help us do assessments on our patients and an idea to help them be better parents for those children and improve the lives of those families in Alamance County. So that's your consideration and approving that funding, please. Unless you have any questions.
Need a motion. Do we need a motion? We do need a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Thanks, sir. Appreciate it.
Thank you. I would like to call on our county manager for his presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just to remind you that to announce where our chairwoman is, and she is out of town, and she should be returning back tonight, so she should be here tomorrow. So she's had a vacation. So I wanted to remind everybody of that. Also, I do want to thank Scott as well for the hard work that he's done. If there was anything that was a labor of love, it was Scott working on that video. And again, as Eddie said, Tim put a lot of work in that as well, and all of MIS. So I do appreciate the work that has been done on that. Again, just to remind you of a couple of dates, we do have the city-county dinner, which will be on Thursday night, the 18th. If you are planning to go, it will be at Best Smith Park, and it will begin at 6 p.m. And if you're interested in going, please let Tori know. And we do, again, the courthouse grand opening is on September 10th, beginning at 10 a.m. To 11, and we'll have tours, and that will coincide with the Let Freedom Ring celebration in Graham. And the last reminder is our next meeting will be the day after Labor Day, which will be Tuesday, September 6th. And that is all I have.
Okay. The next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. Does anybody want to put anything on the consent agenda?
Move for approval.
Move for approval, okay?
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? The agenda pass. Does any commissioners have any comments?
Yeah, I'd like to mention some information here that our county manager provided for us, our finance. Was it last week? With all the information that's been out there about bond ratings and so forth and indebtedness of countries and states, and I guess, you know, we need to be concerned about what our indebtedness is and so forth. I didn't know this report was so accessible. This was done, an analysis of debt of North Carolina counties as of June the 30th of 10 by the State Treasurer, Division of State and Local Government Finance. And it was interesting to see, in my opinion, I hate to give anybody who might use it against us fodder, you know, the conservatives. I'll just leave it at that. I hate to give anybody fodder to use things, to have proof of things they can use against us. And this is going to be fodder for those who think that we can afford to raise taxes, that we can afford to spend more, that we can afford to go in debt more. This is going to be good fodder for them if they think they can use it to any advantage. But there were 21 counties in the population bracket of 100,000 to 249, and 21 including us. And of the 20, other than Alamance County, only three have a lower tax rate than us. And if you look at those three, two of those three have much higher valuations than us, and I would possibly be able to contend that their lower tax rate is probably excessive in the fact that they've got much higher valuations. And then if you come over and you look at the debt load of those three counties, one of them has a 50% higher debt load than us, total debt. One has a 200% higher debt load than us, and the third one has a 400% debt load than us. And a key issue with me was to look at the column of per capita indebtedness, you know, your population versus your total indebtedness divided out. Of those three, the total in, per capita in one was two times what ours was. The second one was three times what ours was or is, and the third one is five times greater. And I don't think there's any way you can look at that category and find where we can be criticized much for tax rates with our peers and or total indebtedness in regards to our peers. I think we're looking good. I mean, you go up and look at Guilford County. Guilford County's bond indebtedness, I know I stated not long ago, it was over $1 billion. I believe it's, God, I need glasses, 1.2 or 1.1 billion to our, what is it, 80, I've written over 85?
86.
Yeah, $86 million in regards to their 1.2 billion. I mean, a tenth, less than a tenth, and they're only three times our size. And I think everything's relative when it comes to the numbers here, and I think we're looking good. And, so there's some more fodder for those that want us to raise taxes, and that we can afford it, and that we can borrow more money. I wouldn't agree with them, but those are good numbers.
Okay.
Bill, I know we just passed this consent agenda, but just for public information, you may want to read that, what we did on this ordinance here, because as of September 26th, the courthouse door will move back to the courthouse. I know we went by that, and I should have said before that, but I'm just thinking, just for public information, see, beginning on September 26th. We're redesignating the courthouse here instead of going across the road here.
Right. Yes, sir.
For public notices on foreclosures, tax liens.
Okay, we will read this. Beginning on September 26, 2011, the Alamance County Historical Courthouse at 1 Court Square, Graham, North Carolina, shall serve as a county courthouse for Alamance County, and the south wall of the vestibule on the first floor of Alamance County Historical Courthouse shall serve as the site of the courthouse door, the courthouse bulletin board, and the courthouse steps. For posting of notices or performances of art of acts that are required by the law to be posted or performed on or such a site.
So the public knows, because
okay,
when it's on consent agenda, it doesn't really get brought out. So.
Okay.
We're canceling September meeting.
That just moving it a day.
Just moving it. That's right. Yes, Monday, sir, to Tuesday.
Yes, sir.
Does anyone have any announcements? Okay. If there are no announcements, we will call it a journey.
Hammer that.
Good job, brother.
Good job. Yeah.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.